That George to talk about to Apache SIS. I have already talked about some feature in previous Apache presentation, but today I will try to put some visualization on some of those features. So the visual components are something new. And I will also talk a little bit about work related to Python, which is just beginning. And I think could be maybe complementary to the Python work done by the next presentation after mine. I don't think that they overlap yet, but those people maybe will be able to tell me more about that. So George talked about abstract specification a little bit before. The most popular OGC specification are web services specification or specification about format, like GeoTIFF, GML, moving feature encoding. Those things, they are very well-known OGC specification. The abstract specification are not as well-known, but they are the specification that give a direction or a framework to other specification that OGC is doing. Those specifications are defined by UML. And those UML are, I think, very useful for designing software after that. So here, there is some of abstract specification that provide such UML. So we have metadata, referencing, feature, and stuff like that. So the important thing is that the specification just describe the concept, and the encoding is defined in separated specification. So for example, for referencing by coordinate, ISO 9111 defines the abstract concept, and ISO 19162 defines the well-known text encoding format. So why it is important, I think, to care about those models? Well, there is a saying that for every complex problem, there is a solution simple, neat, and wrong. And in the geospatial world, a good example of that was the temptation to use WGS84 as a universal hub. This approach has been used a lot. This is what EPAG was used to call the early binding approach. So it's easy, but it's not very difficult to find example of case where it can only produce an error. This error is not very big. It may be something like 1 meter, 2 meters. So is it important or not? It depends what we are doing. But the problem is that in many cases, we had no information about this error. So if we use ISO 19111 as a blueprint for creating a software, this helps a lot to avoid this kind of problem. So this is very useful as a blueprint. It is free, at least the one that are developed conjointly with OGC. An example of implementation that use the ISO model, they are Apache SIS and Proj. In the open source software, they are the only two. Well, there is also GeoTools, but Apache, Proj, and GeoTools are the only project, to my knowledge, which is following closely the ISO 19111 model. So many other projects may have this problem of using WGS84 as a universal hub. I would say, even if someone does not care about standard, in my opinion, standards are important, but even if someone does not care about standards, it's still useful, in my opinion, to take a look at the specification in order to get the concept for doing things as good as possible. So the JoyAPI interface, it's a set of interface defined as an OGC working group for creating Python and Java interface from those UML. So we do that, a mix of automatic process and manual process. At the end, everything is checked manually. At this time at OGC, there is a very strong tendency to use OpenAPI. We did not yet have the time to evaluate how OpenAPI could apply to JoyAPI. My only word of caution would be to be very careful about anything that generates automatically an API from XSD or from other file format. We had experience with XSD in XML world in the past. Automatically generated API tend to not be very good. In my opinion, the best way to generate an API is still to create them manually from UML. But I did not have the chance to look at OpenAPI yet. So we have Python in development, Python abstract class, and Java interface. The Python interface covers only metadata and referencing by coordinate at this time. So I don't think it overlaps with what other people are doing in Python. That would be an open discussion maybe for later. We don't have yet a C++ API that is implementation neutral, but the approach C++ API is very close because it is derived from the same abstract specification, ISO 19111. If some people were interested to create an implementation neutral API in C++, it may be worth to look at Proj as a starting point, but that will be an effort to be done by other people. So for now in JoyAPI, the latest release is JoyAPI 3.0.1, and there is a development branch for JoyAPI 3.1 and 4.0. 3.1 will be backward compatible. 4.0 may break compatibility because some recent evolution of ISO standard, some of them have some incompatible change. So no JoyAPI implementation. There is a binding with Proj using Java native interface. The link is there on this slide. If there is a volunteer for bringing that project to OSGEO, who will be very happy about that. I can volunteer for contributing to the code if people want, but if someone wants to be chair of the project who care about keeping the project, taking care of the project, it would be better to be someone else. So if everyone can volunteer for that, that would be very nice. And the Apache SIS project, which is the project that contribute to. So it started 7 years ago. The 1.0 release was last year. And the version number follow the JoyAPI version number. So SIS 1.anything will be backward compatible with JoyAPI 3, current JoyAPI. And when OGC will publish a JoyAPI 4.0, we will release a SIS 2.0 at that time. So below is a list of some of the module in Apache SIS. So the current landscape is shown on this presentation. So if someone wants to do a Java application there, the Java developer have the choice between Proj using Java native interface or Apache SIS. JoyAPI provide an abstract level that allow developer to use Proj or Apache SIS without the need to know what they are using exactly. They can switch the implementation from one or the other without changing the code. It still works. It's also possible if they want to use directly Apache SIS or directly Proj. But in this case, of course, they lost the implementation neutrality. It's also possible for Python developer to use TrueAPI. At this time, we do not yet have Python implementation, direct Python implementation. We have indirect Python implementation because TrueAPI provide a bridge between Java and Python. So Python developer can use any Java implementation of TrueAPI, which means indirectly Proj or Apache SIS. So of course for Python, it's a little bit convoluted in the case of Proj, because Python developer could use Proj in a much more direct way, but we don't yet have a direct implementation of TrueAPI for Proj in Python. But the indirect way with the bridge work. George gave a note about the recent progress update in ISO specification. There is a good video made by the guys who published the APHG database that explain what is about, what is this dynamic datum, dynamic CRS stuff. So I recommend to take a look at this video. It's not very long, it's 5 minutes, I think, something like that. And it explains well the stuff with the problem with CRS, why we need dynamic CRS. So we could summarize by saying that static CRS is often fixed to a continental plate. So the coordinate in a static CRS tend to be stable. Static CRS is often defined by some national agency. In America, it may be NAD, I forgot the name. It's NAD, NAD CRS, if I remember right. Europe have their CRS fixed to the continental plate here. Australian have a CRS fixed to the Australian plate. So when using those static CRS, the coordinate stay stable for a time long enough. I know that some people tend to use WGS84 because it seemed to be easy. But my recommendation would be, if using data in Australia, for example, use the Australian CRS. If your data are in USA, use the American CRS. If your data are in Europe, use the CRS of whatever country your data is. Keep the WGS84 for the case where you really need data that cover many countries or that cover the world. It is the relationship between dynamic CRS and static CRS that move with time. So, okay, just a minute, I will share the link for the video. There it is. Okay. Okay. So when using a global CRS like WQCS 84, we need to set where the coordinate was taken in order to be able to relate that to a static CRS. So an important thing to realize is that this epoch, this time, is it goes with the coordinate. It does not go with the CRS. There is also an epoch related to the CRS, but it's not the same thing. So what will be the roadmap for supporting this new reference system? What is the roadmap for supporting that? First, we need to update the JoAPI interface. In this slide, I show some of the new elements in the ISO specification that we will need to put in JoAPI as new interface or new method. Then we will need to update Apache SIS for those new interface, also update the Prush Java Native Interface wrapper for those new interface. In the case of Apache SIS, we will need to update to PHG database version 10, which has already been updated for the new ISO standard. Prush also has a plan for a similar upgrade. And we will need to upgrade the well-known text 2 support in Apache SIS. So the red element are examples of new stuff that we will need to support. In this case, Prush is in advance. Prush already support the latest well-known text 2 revision, but not yet the red element as far as I know, but the remaining of OneNote Text 2 latest revision, I think they do. So what Apache SIS can do, there is an example of a line of code for opening a file. In this case, I just print the metadata. The interesting stuff is that every file format has a different way to organize the metadata. There is an example with netcdf. Apache SIS use ISO 19115 as its universal metadata format. So every other file format, the metadata are converted to ISO 19115. So there is an example. Below, on the top, it is the API for doing that. What is look like in an application? So we are starting to develop a JavaFX application. It's just starting. It is in a very, really early stage, but it gives an idea of what Apache SIS can do. It does not show everything, but it shows some aspect. For this presentation, I take data from Japan JAXA as an example. Those JCOMC data are quite a challenge to display. Sometimes they cross the anti-meridian. The localization, the way to put them on a map is not direct. There is a localization map that is not easy to handle, stuff like that. So the fact that Apache SIS can display those data is an indication that the referencing engine behind it is not bad. When showing data, it can give an overview of metadata. So this is just a summary of ISO 19115 metadata in a way that we can visualize a little bit more easy. And no matter how the metadata was organized in the file, this application always shows the metadata in the same way. So this is a tree, a metadata tree, following ISO 19115. It can be exported in XML format as defined by ISO, GML, or when no text in the specific case of CRS element. So other thing that Apache SIS can do, the way to get a coordinate reference system from an APG code, or when no text, or a GML document. So this is example of code. In the application, it appears like that. So we can have a list of CRS available. For every CRS, we can have the domain of validity. We can Apache SIS will give a warning if the CRS that we select is not valid for the raster that we are showing right now. We can have the representation in OneNote Text 2. It's not showing how to parse the OneNote Text, but SIS can do that. How to get a coordinate operation, an object for doing transformation between two CRS. There is an example. An important aspect is that we specify the area where we want to apply a projection, a transformation. In some case, for some pair of CRS, especially in North America, there is many possible operations. So, for example, if we want to do a transformation from NAD 83 to WGS 84, it's not the same thing if we are in USA or in Canada. So we are better to say, I am in USA or in Canada or in Cuba. So we can specify that. We can know the domain of validity and the accuracy of the transformation. Apache SIS can transform point, of course, but it can also transform envelope, taking in account that it's not sufficient to transform the four corners. We have to expand the envelope a little bit more for taking the minimum or the maximum. So transformation, how it look like in the application. There is an example transforming from WGS 84 to a universal transverse Mercator. I will show a live application later if it works. And an indication, some of the Apache SIS features appear in very small details when we look at the application, things that are not very obvious. But for example, if we apply a transformation and there is a change of datum, we got an estimation of the accuracy because of the change of datums. In this particular example, the accuracy is very large because in this case, in the datum that it's applied in this demo, it has no datum shift information, but otherwise it will be something like 100 meters or 10 meters or 2 meters. One thing that Apache SIS can do, it has the capability to also provide Jacobian matrix in addition of the point that we transform. So Jacobian matrix, basically it said, in this transformation, if I move before a transformation at this location, if I move 1 degree longitude to the east, what would be the displacement in this projection? Or if I move 1 degree of latitude to the north, what would be the displacement, the move in this projection? And those vectors are different for every location. They are not the same here than here. So Jacobian matrix are very useful. When we get used to that, there is many, many use of that. So in the previous slide, when I said that Apache SIS can expand the bounding box to include the minimum, behind the hood, it used the Jacobian matrix for doing this computation faster and more accurately. It can also be used for computing how many digits I need to show accurately a coordinate on the screen, taking in account that this amount will change with the zoom, with the location on the map. If I move on the map, the number of digits needed to represent the coordinate of 1 pixel on screen will not be the same. So Jacobian matrix are very useful for computing that. A little demo. So I am going to change application. So there is the application starting. To open file, we just drag and drop. So I will try to find one. So there is the location where we can find them. The metadata, as I said before, we can export them. It does not show on the screen. The contextual menu does not appear, but we can export them to XML. So try to find one with interesting, nice data to see. So for example, in the case of map projection, again, another use of Jacobian matrix, even if there is rotation, even in case of rotation of stuff like that, when there is a change of map projection, it can do that in such a way that the map projection, okay, it does not appear in an obvious way on the screen with a change the projection, but it keeps the projection, the shape, the scale, the orientation of the location where the mouse click has happened. Coordinates are in the bottom. Apache SIS can make the difference between why a data is missing. So it may be a cloud, it may be land. I will try to make them visible. Just random color. So there is none on this image. You can do all the usual stuff, the interpolation without mixing the temperature with the why my data are missing. Under the hood, for the developer, missing data are represented by not a number, NRN number, but the trick that is not used a lot is that the international standard for floating point number actually allow many NAN, not a number value. There is not just one not a number value. We can have many of them. So Apache SIS use different kind of not a number for cloud, for missing data, for land, and stuff like that. So for the developer, it's easy to do numerical computation and still without taking care about missing data and still be able to know why a particular value is missing. The metadata, I have already showed that. For the interoperability demo, I did not have the time to update the demo. I have an old demo between Proj and Apache SIS showing the interoperability that I have spoke before. I did not have the time to update the demo for Proj 7. So I only have the old demo on video for Proj 4, but I hope it will give the idea. So that was an example on the console, but the same kind of thing can be done on a Java, on a graphic application like the one I just showed before, and also in Python, in a Jupyter console. So there is an example. The interesting thing in this demo is that without changing any line of code, just moving file around, you can use one implementation or the other. So it's even possible to put the two implementation in same time on the class path, and the application, as you see, find that dynamically what implementation are available and can use both of them together in the same application. So this simple example in the console can work also in JavaFX or can work in Python in a Jupyter application. So in the Python example, same kind of example in Jupyter using Python. In this case, it's showing metadata instead of doing a coordinate transformation. So doing a metadata using Apache SIS or using JDAL through the same Python API. But I think that for this part, for Python API, the next presentation is going to show more, much more probably. What could be done if Python people have an interest for that, what I would suggest is the Python abstract class derived from UML. There is referencing and metadata abstract class defined in JPI that could be considered. Everything that is at a higher level, like loading file or displaying to screen, can be done in another project. The rationale for this split is that a guideline for JPI, JPI as an OGC working group does not create any new concept. It just takes concepts that are defined by other OGC groups and create a Java or Python API for that. If there is anything that is not defined by another OGC standard, an existing OGC standard, then if we want an API for that, it has to be done outside your API. So that can be the project outside for loading file, displaying file, and stuff like that. For now, your API in OGC focus only on metadata referencing or other stuff that are defined by OGC abstract specification. Is there any question?
Martin, thank you very much. I'll go ahead and watch the chat here for a few seconds to see if other folks have questions. It looks like Tom, who's speaking up, speaking next, is in this. So I'm asking if he's got any questions about the Python API. One of the things, since you also spoke about the dynamic coordinate reference systems, one of the questions I have is, do there need to be changes to GeoAPI to coordinate with what's available in the later versions of Proj that support, like you said, Proj 7, that support that? And if that happens, does that mean we have to wait for an SIS 2.0 in order to pick up and use some of those benefits?
For Proj, they don't have to wait because Proj follow ISO 19111, but does not use an API defined in JoAPI. They define their API directly into Proj. So it has both advantage and inconvenient. The advantage is that they can move fast. The inconvenient is that it is Proj specific. So someone that use Proj API, they can only stay on Proj. They cannot move easily to another implementation. For JoAPI, so it includes the Java native interface to Proj. So in this case, we may have to wait for JoAPI 4.0 to get out in order to get the new stuff with dynamic datum. Well, yes and no. It's always possible for an implementation to define their own API in the meantime. So for example, if we do that in Apache SIS, Apache SIS is free to define, or any other project is free to define their own API to take advantage of latest improvement in ISO specification. But this API is specific to Apache SIS, and any project that uses this API is linked to Apache SIS. If we want to use an API in an implementation neutral way, then we have to wait for JoAPI 4.0. But any developer who is willing to give up the implementation neutral way aspect, those developers does not need to wait.
All right, that makes sense. So it sounds like if we wanted to see these things come to GUI API, like you said, that may be something that happens in version 4.0. In the meantime, there's nothing to stop Apache SIS or even the Proj JNI project or other Java JVM-based Proj libraries from coming up with their own implementation. They just wouldn't be implementing the interface.
Yes. To my understanding, Proj already they already provide the API for dynamic datom, I think, but I think they do not implement yet. They did not implement them yet. So I think that Proj already has the hook. It's just not yet implemented. In the case of Apache SIS, we don't have the hook. So in the case of Apache SIS, we have nothing yet. We have to do the hook, the API, and the implementation.
All right, great. So Tom responded in the session chat, and he said that it'd be great to discuss integration possibilities and suggested maybe chatting about it on the Pi GeoAPI Gitter channel.
Okay.
So he's got a link to that in the session chat, and yeah. Our starting in about 3 minutes. Are there any last-minute questions or anything you'd like to share, Martin?
I am done. Any question?
All right, great. In that case, I'd say we should go ahead and head over to the next channel, which would be Tom and Francesco speaking about the Pi GeoAPI. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thanks, Al.